So next, I would like to introduce Dr. Zakir Hussain, sir. He did his MSc ENT and DOHNS from England. His area of expertise is endoscopic sinus surgeries, micro-laryngeal surgeries, sleep and vertigo. So he has worked in Kuwait,
Hello.
in Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, and CMC Vellore. And he is currently working in KIMS Kollam. He has written many books, out of which exactly 6 books he have written. So first book is otorhinolaryngology for theory purpose. Then he has written instruments in ENT, then manual in clinical ENT, emergencies in clinical ENT, handbook of common ENT surgeries, and now he is coming up with a new book named Current ENT Diagnosis. So I would like to welcome Dr. Zakir Hussain sir to give us insights on how to attempt a the instrument station and other implants like middle ear implants and other. So, sir, you can start the presentation, sir. Zakir Hussain, sir. Just give me a minute. Ha, yes, sir. Sir, you have to unmute yourself, sir. Sir, you have to unmute yourself.
Okay,
Yes, sir.
now
Yes, sir. You can start, sir.
good evening everybody. So this session, next 30 minutes will be on instruments in ENT. The time given to me is just 30 minutes, which is very short. I'll try to go through the instrument as much as possible. And let us start with rhinology. Actually, I put all the instruments together, but most of the instruments, the common ones, I'll be just skipping through. Just for the completion sake, I put in all the instruments.
Sir, if you think that a particular instrument is important,
the most probable
please
one,
mention
which is
it.
kept for the exam.
Yes, sir. Yes,
Yeah,
sir.
I will go in detail.
Yes,
To
sir. Yes,
start with, pudicum nasal speculum is a diagnose, whatever indication, like diagnostic or therapeutic. Then coming to St. Clair Thompson long blade nasal speculum, Ilian self-retaining nasal speculum, Frere's elevator. Here you should know it is used mainly to elevate the mucoperitoneal and mucoperitoneal flap and to lateralize the inferior turbinate, even to perform uncinectomy and to harvest central tissue. And Howarth elevator, how it differs from the Frere elevator is that in Howarth elevator, one end is blunt, the other end is sharp. The blunt end is mainly for the elevation of the mucoperitoneal and mucoperiosteal flap. The sharp end is when you want to disarticulate from the lower end, when where it is attached to the, so where it, leads a sharp dissection. This is Killian's bonnet shaped nasal gouge for reduction of the spur. This is life. The word swell means anything which revolves around two bars. Actually, this knife has been used mainly for SMR. Now for septoplasty, if you want to remove the inferior strip, that can be done with this. Now suction elevator. This is very handy instrument. In the sense, we can elevate the flap at the same time the vision also will be very clear. Coming to him and turbinectomy system. As you all know, it's usually not done, though it's partial or complete. It's no longer done. So we have so many procedures for terminoplasty. So this instrument now is mainly used to cut the cartilage during the term. Coming to Sandoz a side biting antral punch. This is a true cut instrument. It removes bone and soft tissue from the lateral wall of the nose. And it can be used even for widening of the maxillary sinus ostium. Even the uncinate remnant, if it is left behind, even the. This is Jensen's militant septum foot, used mainly for removal of the cartilaginous and bony septum during stroke. This is cartilage crusher used to morselize harvested cartilage pieces for septoplasty and rhinoplasty. These are the steps of septoplasty, which I will not be going in detail. We'll go only through the instrument. This is the Walsham's forceps and Ash forceps. Walsham's forceps, you'll find as in the screen, you'll find a rubber in one end, and that is mainly for reduction of the nasal bone fracture, to realign nasal bone fracture. And the Ash forceps, which is little stout and the bend and the gap between two blades, which is for straightening and alignment of the nasal septum. This is the Rose Eustachian tube catheter. This is no longer used as Eustachian tube catheterization. It is mainly used for removal of foreign body. And you have the ring at one end. Of the tip of the instrument. Coming to rigid nasal endoscopes. It's about 18 centimeters long, and we have adult and pediatric and different angles also. As shown in the figure, we have 0 degrees, 30 degrees, 45, 70, and 120. Rigid nasal endoscopy has revolutionized rhinology and the surgical part too. So you have adult and pediatric. Adult, it is 4 millimeter, and pediatric 7 and 2.1. Now, here I would like to say that we have a new endoscope which is called endochameleon. Like how I have mentioned before, that for each angle, like each angle, you need to 0 degree, separate one for 30, separate one for 45, 70, and 120. This chameleon nasal telescope, in a single endoscope, you can get angles starting from 15 to 90. So, as you see in this third diagram, right photograph, it's starting from 15 to 90, you get all different angles in a single endoscope. You don't have to change the angles. This is the latest one. This picture shows nasal endoscopy and nasal video endoscopy too. Bear in mind, that each endoscope, whether it is 0, 13, 45, and 70, yes, Dr.
Sir, your voice is a little bit husky, sir. Can you please come closer to the mic? And can you please repeat this endochameleon nasal telescope, sir?
Sure.
Please, sir.
See, endoscope, rigid endoscope, we get in different angles. Starting from 0 degree, 30, 45, 70, and 120. So you have to change the scope. Suppose you need to have different angulation, you need to change the scope. You have a new one, which is endochameleon nasal endoscope, where you don't have to change the endoscope. The single endoscope itself, you get all different angles, starting from 50 to 90. As you see in the third photograph, you have different arrows, and it shows that 15 degrees to 90 degrees. The single endoscope itself, without changing the telescope or endoscope, you can get all different angles. That is about chameleon nasal endoscopy. And you should bear in mind that each endoscope, the older version, they've got a color code. 0 degree is green, with a color code given at the handle. 0 degree is green, 30 degree is red, 45 is black, and 70 degree is yellow. And even there are so many different techniques of holding the endoscope. Side grip, base grip, reverse, claw grip, pistol grip. I'm not going into it. Now coming to the test instrument. So just name a few, then we'll come back to it. Little scalpel, basically wheel forces, where to remove the polyp, and it's not a lapel. And regarding this instrument, there's always the space between the blade is limited. We cannot open it like near the instrument. And if you can notice, there's an eye noted at the upper jaw to visualize the tissue. This gives a difference between the Kisly forceps and the Takahashi forceps. Now, coming to rhinophore forceps, here, there's a true cut. It cuts clearly, cleanly through the tissue and avoids tearing of the tissue. This is anterior punch forceps, where with this we can do uncinectomy as well as widening of the maxillary sinus ostium. In this, the new and a recent advancement is the rotating back biter is available. That is, you don't have to use one for the left and one for the right, one for the upper one for the lower one. So you have a rotating back biter too. Now, coming to the nasal system, Sinus or CMC, antrum grasping forceps. It comes with a name by Hoesus, antrum grasping forceps. This is mainly used for removal of the cyst or polyp or any tissue which is left behind in the maxillary sinus. And even it can be used for removal of the ethmoidal air cells. Hoesus, antrum grasping forceps. This is a cup curette to curette all the ethmoid air cells. And this is giraffe forceps, cone ball gut giraffe forceps. It's available in 45 degrees and 90 degrees. The jaw opening can be from side to side or from front to back. It's made mainly to assess the frontal reflex. Standard the mushroom punch. This one is mainly used for widening the sphenoid ostium. About the instrument, if you can see the tip, it's blunt. It is shaped like a mushroom too. Actually, the cutting edge is here, like how I am showing with the marker. So this is mainly used for the sphenoid ostium. This one also, it comes in straight as well as in angled. Straight one is used for sphenoid and angled one can be used for frontal recess. Next, coming to the debrider handpiece and the console. You see the handpiece, the parts are, you have a cannula, which is a inner cannula, outer cannula, and the inner cannula. Then the irrigation part and the suction. What you see in the picture, see on the right side, is the console. In the cannula, you have, it comes in different angulation, starting from 40, 60, 120. So 120, again you have, even in 60, you have two types. One is forward facing, one is reverse. Reverse facing is mainly for doing adenoidectomy or any nasopharyngeal mask. As far as the blades are concerned, you can say the blades can be divided as per the edges. It can be divided as smooth edges or serrated edges. Serrated edges can be again subdivided as single serrated or double serrated, which means I'm talking about the inner cannula, not the single serrated and double serrated. The inner, both are. Depending upon the type of edges of the serrated, again it can be subclassed with a sharp blade and tri-cut blade. It comes in different size. Sharp blade is 3.5 and it comes in 4, and tri-cut it comes in 2.9, 3.5 and 4. So the mechanism of action, the cutting mode can be oscillation, dabbing or rotation. These are types. So these are the steps of stress which I will not repeat. Next, coming to the instruments for rhinoplasty. The first one is Cottle's columnar clamp. Second one is Kilner's ALR retractor. So Kilner's ALR retractor to visualize the vestibular area. As you know, you have a columnar incision and the marginal incision. Marginal incision has got the medial limb and a lateral limb. For the incision of the lateral limb, we can make an examination. We can make use of this Kilner's ALR retractor. Next is optic nasal retractor for exposing the nasal lobe. This is Joseph elevator, periosteal elevator. They lay the periosteum over the nasal bones. This is chisel straight for reduction of the nasal hum. Nasal hum can be bony, it can be both cartilaginous and bony. So I'll show you a picture for that separately how it is removed. Nasal rasp. It comes in 10 different sizes, starting from 1 to 10. And this rasping edge is made up of tungsten carbide, like how the burr is made, same material. Now coming to the osteotome. You have both sides, left and right one. And this edge which you see, which is blunt, so that it can avoid trauma to the lateral edge. And the cutting edges are the inner one. So these are the steps. Inverted gulving, mid columnar incision. This is a marginal incision which I was talking about. Medial limb, then you have the lateral limb. Complete exposure of the nasal dorsum. Here you have the chisel removing the hum, and you have the off-ridge retractor too. There is the position of the lateral, for the lateral os. Once the bony upper part work has been done, we come to the tip, where you have intradermal and interdermal sutures, and finally the closure. There's a few words about these three, like Mirosal, Surgisal, and Asopo. Mirosal is made up of polyvinyl alcohol in the compressed form, which we are using for every case of test. I repeat, Mirosal is made up of polyvinyl alcohol in compressed form. Surgisal, it is an oxidized regenerated cellulose. It has got three actions. Adheres to bleeding surface. Second, it has got a vasoconstrictive effect. It is low pH of the product. Third one, it is antibacterial effective. That is anti-staphylococcus, anti-streptococcus, in fact, anti-pseudomonas. Nasopore, because this is synthetic polyurethane form, which is biodegradable. Now, for epistaxis, we have four different techniques of management. Either it can be electrocautery, or chemical cautery, thermal cautery, or it can be cryo, which you see is for electrocautery. The second one is chemical cautery, which contains silver nitrate. So I hope how it works. Silver nitrate produces, it combines with moisture or saline, or mainly moisture in the nasal cavity, and produces nitric acid, which cauterizes the IBS. Now, that's about the rhinology part. Coming to the otology part, the first one is endo-oral speculum. So as you all know, now we are in the generation where we are in endoscopic surgery. So I don't think that all this endo-oral speculum will be kept in for the exam, even then, just for the completion. So if you know the indications and type of incision, like William Wiles incision, modified William Wiles incision, Heerman's incision, Lempert's 1, 2, 3, 4 type of incense oral syringe, Jobson Horn's probe ring curate, Gardner Brown's tuning fork, and different mechanisms, Hertz has been used, and what are the different techniques for Rennie's test, and mechanism of Weber's test, and Aaron theory, dispersion theory. These are the basics. Coming to the myringotomy, for making an incision of the tympanic membrane. So, mainly there are three different type of grommets which will be kept. One is Shah grommet, other is Shepherd, other is Armstrong. In Shah, if you can see, we have an inner flange and an outer flange. And you can see that whenever there is a shoe horn, it has got two actions. That is easy insertion and late extrusion. The other side, what you see is an outer flange. Indications of grommet you should be knowing, and there are so many different type of grommets. So many, I can name at least 50 to 70. The most common ones are Shah, Shepherd, and Armstrong. So these are the few ones which I have just repeated.
Sir, can you go a little bit slow, sir? Because the instruments are very interesting, sir.
You want me to go slow or fast?
Yes, sir. Little bit slow, sir.
Oh. So, this is a T-tube introducer. And here you have T-tube. It can be fashioned. And it has been introduced inside the introducer, like how it's shown in the picture. And you should know the different indications for T-tube. These are the common questions. If during surgery grommet falls into the middle ear, what has to be done? What are the indications for mini Shah grommet? What are the indications for T-tube? How do you treat recurrent otorhinal patients with grommet in play? And very rarely, what is your can principle in grommet incision? So this is about pictures on laryngectomy, incision, aspiration, grommet incision, insertion, and grommet imposition. Now, next one, Mollison's link hemostatic mastoid retractor, Farabius periosteal elevator, Lempert mastoid scoop, burr, and the material which is made up of its tungsten carbide or titanium. The diameter of the cutting burr, we should start from 0.5 to 7 millimeters, and the length, it varies from 45 to 70 millimeters. So as far as the diamond burr is concerned, you have two types. So it is either irregular for cutting, for regular rough surface for polish. There's house microtutorite, there's Rosen's knife, Lister flag knife, and a bill. Rosen's knife and Lister knife both are used for incision in the external artery canal for elevation of the flap. And Bill's knife, which is blunt and thick, as you see, for placement of the graft. Then you have angle pick and straight pick. Right? And crocodile forceps and cup forceps. This is sclerotomy scissors. It is piston crimper. Now, coming to auto telescopes. Usual length is 10 cm with a diameter in three different range, starting from 1.9 to 2.7 and 4 mm. And we get in four different angles, 0 degree, 30, 45, and 70. Indications, as I know, it has to be diagnostic and surgery. This is Spencer's nystagmus spectacle. It comes in 20 degree convex lens. It prevents visual fixation so that nystagmus can be seen. It can be enhanced and seen properly. Magnified view. Coming to the hearing aid, you can have a picture or a model, and they may ask you, please pass, where is the microphone? So at this point, you should know the types of hearing aid. Mark the microphone area. What do you mean the cross hearing aid? What is the function of vent? What does one mean by inadequate benefit from the hearing aid? Now, bone anchored hearing aid. So this has got three parts: the implant, the abutment, and external sound process. So you'll be asked to identify mechanism of action. What are the advantages, disadvantages, and what are the timing of surgery, and what are the complications? And the last one I have added up. In case MR has to be done, what has to be done? See, the external sound processor, it contains a ferrous part, and titanium is very compatible with MRI. So suppose in case the patient with a bone anchored hearing aid is undergoing an MRI procedure, only the external sound processor has to be removed. So these are the steps of surgery for Baha. So first the implant has to be fixed. Next the abutment. So this is the implant. And this is that. Next, you have partially implantable hearing device and fully implantable hearing device. In partially implantable hearing device, you have vibrating ocular processes. And one which is fixed to the incus is a floating mass transducer. So, as far as these two sessions are concerned, either the bone anchored hearing aid, this one can be kept, or it will be the vibrating ocular process which can be kept. So the latest one is an auditory brainstem implant. We don't have a picture for that. So at least you should know three or four indications. The common ones are, the contraindications is things the other way around. The contraindications for cochlear implant will be the indications for brainstem implant. Like the common indications are cochlear nerve aplasia, traumatic cochlear nerve avulsion, failed cochlear implantation, ossification of the cochlea, and it goes on. At least three or four you should know. Now coming to TORP and PAR. So total ocular processes, both have got two parts. One is the head and the shaft, and it is made up of Teflon. So TORP, if you see, the shaft is thin. And the TORP will be thick. As far as the TORP is concerned, the shaft should be placed on the foot plate of the baby, and TORP should be placed on the head of the baby. So processes can be made up of natural material, which can be cartilage or bone, or it can be hydroxyapatite or platinum, steel, fluoroplastic or Teflon, and gold. Each one has got its own advantages. Coming to oropharynx. This is boiled devil's mouth gag. We have so many different types of mouth gag. This is boiled devil's progeny, hydrogeny, tell us, and we should know the indications and complications for that. This is Jennings Modiac. This is mainly used in Edenzillus patients. Blade just on the alveolar margin. This is Dingman's mouth gag. This is mainly used in cleft palate repair, palatoplasty, and pharyngoplasty. The advantage is that it has got a tongue depressor, and along with the cheek retractor, it has got small wire spring which can fix the palatal flap. Next is Fenn's bipod stand, which fixes the boiled Davis mouth gag. McGuire and tonsillar bridge or plate, which stabilizes the trapped by both top, was long dissecting forces, wide Evans tonsillar dissector, East tonsillar snare, Morrison's blunt tonsillar dissector, the anterior pillar retractor, Younger suction tube, and Burkett's long slender tonsillar hemostatic forces. Negus tonsil artery forces and the holding forces. This is set for tonsil. Not going through, but here we see the fifth diagram onwards. Incision with the forces, was forces. Second one is a blade. Third one is a scissor. Fourth one is a unipolar diatermy. Fifth one is incision is made or the surgery is done with the help of harmonic scalpel. And even the latest one is a coblation. So, if you see, all these instruments have been going a little fast because I want to concentrate mainly on the coblation, which is the one which is used. Now, the different techniques are, you have coblation wand, lar diathermy, bipolar diathermy, harmonic scalpel, the old one, the new one. So, you should know the difference between coblation and the general unipolar diathermy. Coblation, here you pass the electric current through saline. It creates a plasma layer. When current goes through normal saline, you get ionized sodium ions at 40 to 70 degrees Celsius. This ionized sodium ion, the molecular bond, cellular bonds, that's how it works. And it is bipolar. And the thermal damage is very less. The area is just 1 millimeter. When you compare with electrocautery, it's about 3 to 5 millimeter. And if you can see that the temperature difference in coblation is just 40 to 70 degrees. When you compare with unipolar, it is 300 to average of 400 degrees Celsius. So the damage is more. And of course, the post-operative pain is more. So coblation, the word coblation co stands for controlled ablation, stands for melt. So, to repeat, it utilizes a system of radio frequency, bipolar electrical current, the current that passes through a medium of normal saline, which results in the production of a field of sodium ions. These energetized sodium ions are capable of breaking down intercellular bonds and vaporizes tissue at a temperature of just 60 degrees Celsius. Now, coming to the new advancement, what we are using now is coblator 2. The latest one is Verul. It's called as Verul. The coblator, if you see, you have a system with a separate saline module, and that saline module, it works on the gravity-dependent saline delivery system. And if you see the equipment, it comes in numerical numbers like coblation. You have coblator as well as the coagulate, in which you have numbers starting from 3. So the Verhu system is all in one system, and it works, and the saline, it works as a pump delivered saline, and you have only three markings in that, which is low, medium, and high. This is the latest one. And the Verhu system, even the coblator wand is different. In the sense, the same wand can be used for tonsillectomy and adenoidectomy. You don't have to change it. You see the comparison here. See the difference. This is not reinforced. This halo wand, it is reinforced too. This is a new advancement when as far as the coblation system is concerned. Now, coming to adenoidectomy instrument, Saint Clair Thompson's adenoid curette with cage, without cage, and just test for surgery. Coming to the sixth slide, you can see that it goes sideways. Then you turn it to 90 degrees, hold it like a dagger, and slight flexion of the neck, remove the whole adenoid. This is suction cautery. This is Pelvis Pretonsillar Drainage Forceps. This is for drainage for Quincy. Tongue tie guide, nicknamed as Mickey Mouse Forceps. This is for the release of tongue tie. Laryngeal treatment, direct laryngeal flow, type, indication, technique, and complications should be known. And these are the tests for laryngoscopy, the position, mouth guard, how it is introduced, visualization of fuel, epiglottis, and examination of the larynx. Anterior commissure laryngoscope, it gives advantage of fit examination of the anterior commissure, posterior commissure, as well as the subglottis. This is laryngoscopy with chest stand and MLS intraoral. Flexible fibro-optic. And what you see in the picture, you see in the right side, is a portable one. The field of view is 85 degrees. Range of the tip is 130 degrees up and down. Outer diameter is 5 millimeter. And total working, total length comes to about 585. And working length comes about 360. Here, I could take a few minutes. Like, we should know the steps. Like, first you have to enquire if the patient has already undergone this scope procedure or it is his first experience. Explain the whole procedure to the patient and need to avoid, and you have to tell the patient he has to avoid food intake for next 20 to 30 minutes. Anatize, wear a glove, examine the endoscope properly. Anesthetize the nasal cavity, lubricate the endoscope, apply anti-fog. Introduce the endoscope through the patent nasal cavity. At this point, when you introduce through the nasal cavity, the patient is advised to breathe through the mouth. Once the parent advises the patient to breathe through the nose at this point, negotiate into the oropharynx. When it is in the oropharynx, ask the patient to protrude the tongue and it gives better examination of the malacca. Next, ask him to say the word E repeatedly to note the mobility of the vocal cord, and next to ask him to breathe in and breathe out so that if there is any vocal cord polyp, it can be seen. If you want to examine the piriform fossa, it can be done in 2 days. You ask the patient to do a valsalva manner or ask him to turn the head to the left or right to see the corresponding piriform fossa which opens. From this step onward, if suppose a following study has to be done, then we can proceed with the following study. In case the flexoscopy has been done, to rule out sleep apnea, two things have to be done. We have to do Muller's manual, which is nothing but reverse vascular manual, and we have to do a VOAT scoring. Second one, the new one is end expiratory retroglossal area. Coming to the next instrument. This is oropharyngeal laryngeal foreign body removal force. Next, going to the trachea. This is part of the tracheostomy tube. You can see the all the points are given, the numbering has given. This end is a balloon valve for the pilot balloon. Then you have the inflation line. Then you have the connector, flange, outer cannula. 7 is the cup. Cannula and the obturator. You know the types of tube, material, what it is made up of, indications, a few indications of tracheostomy, few complications of tracheostomy, and what are the different legs starting from the skin till you reach the trachea. These are different types of tubes, like so many different types of tubes, cortex tube, Fuller's tube, Jackson tube, Shelley tube, so many others. This is a new one, LAN system. It's in the cup. Each time you inflate air into it, you are supposed to use, as I saw in this, you are supposed to use a cuff manometer and keep the pressure between 15 and 25 centimeters of water. what happens is if it is over injected in land system, which is a new one, if by any reason the intracranial pressure increases, the extra pressure it goes into this system. So that pressure is not transmitted to the, then you have the uncuffed tube. Uncuffed tube, you should know the indications of uncuffed tube. As you know, it's mainly used in children for radiotherapy and for speech also. Advantages, contraindications. What are the normal use of cuff? It stabilizes the tube. It prevents aspiration. If you want to give a positive pressure ventilation, you need a cuff. And what are the disadvantages of the same? The disadvantages of cuff, like practical alteration, swallowing is impaired. So if the tube is blocked in the presence of cuff, patient can get the respiratory. Next is adjustable flange. This is mainly indicated when the cutaneous tracheal length is more, like in short neck patients. So you should know the indications and limitations for it. This is a speaking valve. This is a one-way valve. The patient doesn't have to occlude with his finger. And next is occlusion, therefore decannulation. Then there's cuff manometer. Then you have two types of tracheal dilator. That is proceal dilator, Lamport dilator. This is for insertion of the tube. Change the tube also can be used. You have a humidifier, it's called a Swedish nose or HME humidifier. Heat and moisture exchanger. What it does is, it collects the patient's expired heat and moisture and returns it during insertion. Coming to the bronchoscope. So the parts of bronchoscope are, it has got a shaft, it's got a handle. This part, the suction is connected to this part, and you have ventilation, the telescope connection. The difference between the bronchoscope and the user is that bronchoscope has side vent. Usual length of bronchoscope is from 40 to 45 centimeters, is side vent. You should know the indications of bronchoscope, diagnostic and therapeutic indication, and the complex. Adult scope and pediatric scope, it comes in numbers like this, adult 6.5, 10.5 and 8.5. And for pediatric, it starts from 2.5 up to 4.5. And when you use endoscope, now we have the telescope use of bronchoscope. These telescopes are, which is 4 millimeter in adult and 30 centimeters in length. These are the depths of bronchoscope, which I'm not going into detail. Now come to esophagoscope. Esophagoscope, normal length is 40 to 45 centimeters long, 16 to 20 centimeters diameter. You should know the indication, diagnostic and therapeutic. The parts are handle, shaft, IP, light carrier, and the distal opening. And you should know the complications too. You have Jackson scope and esophagoscope. So Jackson scope, illumination is distal, it is a single bulb one, illumination source, and diameter is constant. Whereas in negus, the diameter keeps on tapering distally. That's for a double source of illumination. And in negus, they have markings present on the endoscope. Now, coming to laryngoscopes, you have McIntosh, Magelt, McCoy's laryngoscope. You should know that. Identify the identification and complication for the disease. Uterus oropharyngeal airway, nasopharyngeal airway. Indications and complications. So indications for these are, make the airway patent, in insertion of the suction catheter, and better mask fit too. This is brain mask, because it has been designed by a surgeon called Mr. Brain. This is laryngeal mask airway. The main indication for that is, where facial mask is difficult to use, or in case of failed intubation, or you want to stop intubation like MRI. Complications are high chance of aspiration and airway trauma too. The main advantages are, it's very easy to insert, but possible to insert in any head position too. Endotracheal tubes. The usual material it is made up of is polyvinyl chloride, silicon or latex. Ideal radial curvature is 12 to 16. One end is bevel with the Murphy's eye just opposite to the bevel end. There is a radio-opaque marker line too. This is our Elvin tube. The the curve allows the breathing system connected to be placed away from the surgical tip. So it's mainly used in head and neck surgery. Main disadvantage is it's very difficult to do a suctioning. This is flexo metallic tube. As you see in this picture, second picture, there's a metal spiral bond reinforcement around it. This is used only in those situations where there is high possibility of the tube being pinched. So the main disadvantage will be in this tube will be nasal intubation is difficult and the tube cannot be cut or shortened. Laser flex structure tube. There are two tubes in this, cup in this. This cup is filled with saline and not with air. But
sir, we are not able to. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. It was really very interesting, sir. Even I have never heard about Indo-Chameleon nasal telescope and this Wave-Wool system. So thank you so much for your precious time, sir. I think we all
have covered all the instruments.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You have covered all the instruments, sir. And thank you for giving us your precious time, sir, from your busy schedule.
Well,
yes, sir.
Welcome.